Finally tonight, as she announces her retirement, an icon of children's television looks back at her life and how she got to Sesame Street. Jeffrey Brown has the story.
Here we have it, the part of the body we are going to talk about today. Da-da-da-da-da-da! The head!
It's a show woven into the childhood memories of generations. Much of her life, Sonia Manzano was a major part of Sesame Street.
With the cookies and cupcakes.
As one of its writers and as the actor playing the character
Monster.
Of Maria.
Cookies and cupcakes are good sometimes, but I want everyone to realize that treats like this can be tasty too.
Oh, Maria.
Oh, come on.
This is very disappointing.
Oh, come on. Tea.
She was a beloved figure
Tube
who taught the basics of reading and math.
Of toothpaste.
But also complicated life lessons about love, marriage, sickness, and death.
Husband.
Don't you remember we told you? Mr. Hooper died. He's dead.
Oh, yeah.
For many viewers, she was also the first Latina they saw on television.
So how much of Maria was you?
She's all me. She's a better Sonia. I mean, she's a kinder Sonia. She's a more patient Sonia. But it's all, I went exactly from myself.
And yet the safe, comforting world where Maria lived and worked was very different from the one Manzano grew up in. A story she's now telling in a new memoir, Becoming Maria.
When I started to think about leaving Sesame Street, I started to think about my journey there, and I wanted to examine where I went right and where I went wrong, and how is it possible that a girl from my background could end up on this iconic television show.
Manzano grew up here in the working-class tenements of the South Bronx, born to Puerto Rican immigrants. She describes her father, who worked as a roofer, serenading her with Puerto Rican ballads on the guitar. But he was also an alcoholic with a violent temper, a chaotic presence who beat her mother, destroyed objects around the house, and generally terrified Manzano and her siblings.
In order to escape, like, what was going on in the apartment, I used to, like, look out the window. I used to comb my hair, do my nails, read by the streetlight, sort of like trying to find the furthest place, like being at the end of the boat.
Beaver, don't eat so fast.
She also sought refuge in television of the era, in shows that depicted serene family life, as in Leave It to Beaver and Father Knows Best.
Lost my husband in November.
And in Queen for a Day, a game show that invited down-and-out women to share stories of misfortune in order to win appliances.
I thought my mother could have a good spot on that, on Queen for a Day, and we'd get something out of being miserable. But the other shows were in suburban environments, and so I didn't see the neighborhood that I lived in reflected on television or people. And I have to say that on some level I wondered where I was going to fit into this society that didn't see me, what my contribution was going to be. I decided, no, that's it. I'm going to stand up for myself. And
at school, Manzano found little relief from her chaotic home life. At this junior high school, getting into an early fight to prove herself. She says merely showing up was often enough to pass.
I think I just lost myself in whatever books I could find. I had a feeling that there was something better than this. I just couldn't believe that this was life.
And then came a revelation. When Manzano was 11 years old, a teacher took her to see the film West Side Story, set in a place she knew all too well, but one suddenly cast in a whole new light.
I saw banal things that I saw every day in my neighborhood beautiful, exalted. All of a sudden, the schoolyard fence that I had wanted to climb over was like a painting. The graffiti looked like something you'd see in a museum. Like, I couldn't articulate this, but I think that gave me strength.
A drama teacher encouraged her to audition as an actor for Manhattan's High School for the Performing Arts, and she was accepted. She struggled in a suddenly rigorous academic environment, but her acting helped her gain entry to Carnegie Mellon University in 1968. 1 year later, an idealistic new television show designed to reach inner city children debuted on public television.
I never saw these cheerful, attractive, black, friendly people in this environment that was recognizable to me, with the stoop and the tenement doors. And I said, what's my stoop doing on television? It was thrilling to see the show like that.
In 1971, Manzano auditioned and at age 22 landed the part of Maria, a role she would inhabit for the next 44 years.
So having written the book, I mean, to figure out how you got from here to there, did you figure it out?
No.
No.
No, I think that there's something, there's a connection that I found comfort in television and that I ended up providing comfort or wanting to provide comfort for children who are watching television, that I love theater and I love stories. People say, oh, she overcame a terrible childhood. I say I didn't overcome my difficult childhood. I say that I used it. I made something of it. I never forgot it. I remembered myself watching Father Knows Best and Leave It to Beaver. And so I remembered myself doing that, and I kept that sensibility in my heart while I was doing Sesame Street, with the knowledge that there's another kid out there looking for that sanctuary.
In retirement, Sonia Manzano will continue that pursuit. Among other things, she's now working to establish a children's museum in the Bronx. And from the South Bronx, I'm Jeffrey Brown for the PBS NewsHour.